Jerk alert!
You eat pieces of shit for breakfast?
Tractor beam. Sucked me right in.
He slimed me.
It's not a tumor.
You're killing me, Smalls.
Everyone in this room is now dumber for having listened to it.
So, you want me to say hello? You want me to say, I should say it?
Say whatever, say it.
I should say hello, everybody?
You should say hello, everybody.
Hello, everybody.
What's up, everybody? This is the Movie Roulette Podcast. I am Shrout.
I'm Jason.
I'm Andy.
And we are Aunt Bethany walking up the steps into the Griswold house right now.
You couldn't hear a dump truck driving through a nitroglycerin plant.
That's the second episode in a row that someone has quoted that same line. So,
We did before. I've probably quoted it several times between then.
But what's funny is that's not, well, you know, that's not the movie we're actually watching today, nor was the last time either.
You guys can't see us, but I just turned my hat around so I don't keep bumping my mic. And Andy did the same thing, although his bill is nowhere near a mic stand.
Yeah, you guys look like you're going to arm wrestle like a bunch of dudes.
We're going to fucking over the top this shit.
I feel like
Ricky Sweat. Who is it?
Ricky Sweats. Yeah, it's Ricky Sweats. I think he arm wrestles
Rocky Dennis.
Look at Sylvester Stallone.
Yeah, you know
it's even Rocky.
I was thinking Ricky, and then when he sweated,
Ricky Sweats. So, anyways,
Ricky Tikki Tembo.
Who are we? All right. Oh my god.
Yeah, we went over that already.
Okay.
Hold on. We have a name, and it's
the Movie Roulette Podcast.
I'm just kidding.
Okay, so today. We are discussing Pretty in Pink.
Yay.
We'll get to this, but I feel like there's a lack of excitement from two of you guys.
I we'll get to it. We will definitely get to it. But before we get to that, we need to get to our shots.
It's not a complete hate.
It is not hate, but
all right.
Cheers. Wait. Talk about it. What are you shooting?
Same thing that I did last time. Like, until this thing goes away, I'm doing the banana cream.
Me too. Banana cream. What is it? Moonshine.
I'm just doing whiskey.
And that's larceny. Jason's doing larceny Kentucky Straight Bourbon 1870.
Which I've got mixed into my 44-ounce fountain drink full of Mr. Pibb from the gas station.
I got it with my Sprite.
Now, before we do this, let's talk about our... So we don't have any shot glasses at the moment because Andy didn't clean ours.
Nope.
So we're taking shots out of the smallest little like a ranch cup.
Yep.
That's made out of Tupperware.
I actually bought them for ranch cups for the last time we had a football watch party.
It holds 3 ounces,
and
your shit,
what it says.
You don't even have a shot worth in there.
Yeah, it does.
Mine is like almost to the top.
Well, his is like.
Well, I'm not chugging whipped cream like a bunch of dorks.
Cheers, boys! Cheers, boys!
Cheers!
Don't you talk shit on my makeshift?
What? Oh, that one hit. That one hit differently.
Did you just do the gag noise?
But
okay, so that stuff is fucking delicious.
It is so good.
It's so
Jason,
good.
You got, well, you don't like banana stuff, do you? You don't like.
No,
so
no.
Anyways,
I don't really like whiskey either.
Oh, but so we
as he cracks open a fucking Bud Light.
I don't really like Bud Light either.
He doesn't. You don't like anything.
Okay.
Unlike this movie, Pretty in Pink, starring Molly Ringwald,
Marley Ringwald,
and Rocky Sweats,
starring Molly Ringwald, John Cryer, Harry Dean Stanton, Annie Potts, James Spader, and Andrew McCarthy. Written by the great John Hughes and directed by Howard Deutsch. And if you have not seen this, the quick recap. Andy is an outcast at her Chicago high school, hanging out either with her older boss, who owns the record store where she works, or her quirky classmate, Duckie, who has a crush on her. When one of the rich, popular kids at school, Blaine, asks Andy out, it seems too good to be true. As Andy starts falling for Blaine, she begins to realize that dating someone from a different social sphere is not easy.
It sounded like you were saying bling.
Bling. Blaine. Blaine.
Blaine. That's not a name. That's a major appliance.
B-L-A-N-E. Blaine.
Yeah, did you hear me do the one quote?
No, that was the quote.
That's it. What?
Oh, no, no.
Check that one off your list.
There's several. Oh, is that,
I'm just kidding. I'm just kidding. Yeah.
Duckie does say that, doesn't he?
You're goddamn right he does.
So, initial thoughts. What do you guys like? What are we doing with this one?
I think I've seen this before. I do confuse it a lot with 16 Candles.
That's what I thought we were watching 16 Candles.
Yep, I thought I was going to see Long Duck Dong. Yeah, no, and so I know, like, Andy agrees with me. Yeah, at the end, exchanges in text. He was like, "Oh, this is different." And I'm like, "Oh yeah."
I truthfully don't remember the first time I saw this movie. I know, you know, just vague recollection of watching it several times over the years. And I like it, but it doesn't hold up to 16 Candles or Breakfast Club, or
right.
And doesn't get the mileage that those do.
Yeah, those are other major movies.
Still, you know, probably once a year.
This is one of those that I know I'd seen on TBS or TNT or something like that in piecemeal. So I knew the story.
You knew it well enough to know that Long Duck Dong is in it.
Yeah, but he's then not. He was not. Because I get the two of them confused. Because Molly Ringwald, she's a national treasure. She definitely is. She, like, I have something to say about it. So how about we start with the very first scene?
We open in a lower class neighborhood in Chicago. Pretty in Pink by the Psychedelic Furs plays as Andy is getting ready for her typical day, choosing her outfit from an array of funky self-designed clothing and applying makeup. Andy is then seen waking her father and making the morning coffee. She seems to be running the small household of two. Andy's father, Jack, has trouble waking up on his own as Andy reminds him how important today's job interview will be. Jack quickly turns the conversation back to Andy's school life, inquiring if she had been asked to the prom yet. Andy's face drops as she shrugs off the question with a quick, "No." Jack playfully compliments his daughter's beauty and her talent for making fashionable clothing with secondhand materials. Andy arrives at high school, the halls crowded with teenagers mingling before the first bell rings. We see Blaine, a rich kid who seems to be admiring Andy from afar. We also meet a clearly insecure, loudly dressed Duckie, peacocking down the hall with his little sunglasses and his hipster hat. He's sporting layers of shirts, a vest, an ugly used car salesman's sport coat with a bolo tie, and of course, crusty black Chuck Taylors. Duckie stops at Andy's locker where the two begin their normal morning banter as they walk to their first classes. As Andy sits in class, the teacher is lecturing on FDR policies as a couple of blonde, rich bitches begin to bully Andy about her sense of style. Andy innocently says nothing as the teacher punishes the bitches, causing a deeper issue with the shallow blondes. At the end of Andy's school day, we see her walking to her car when Steph, another rich prick, approaches her. He nags her about going out with him with a sexually aggressive tone. She is clearly irritated by his advances, as he had been trying for 4 years. Andy again dismisses him, causing his usual insults.
I'm sorry, John Cryer has never been cool. And like this, like, solidified it. In 2.5 Men.
Maybe in Hot Shots.
Yeah, but he's never been cool. And like this just solidified it for me.
Yeah. Yeah.
I kind of disagree. I think this is his coolest role.
I think you're wrong.
I don't know that that's saying much.
I have reasons that I'll explain later because we're not there yet. But
I think you're wrong because, like, no, I'm joking.
Do you think that I might be wrong, Duck Dong?
Yeah, you're wrong, Duck Dong. Yeah,
I'll give a little teaser about my thoughts on this that we can get into more later as well. That I'm just going to say that I tend to kind of agree more with the way Molly Ringwald feels as she was filming this movie.
How is that?
Maybe we'll have to get into it.
Okay. Maybe we'll get into it. I've never seen a high school like that ever. And
I love these 1980s high school hallways in these movies.
I mean, they're all the same.
They're like, awesome.
That's what I, when I, when I was in like,
what is it you've grade, never seen? What about this high school that's like, so strange?
The way that they all interact with each other. And like, there's the groups of kids and stuff like that. We never had that. It was like, you go from class to class and everybody just goes. I didn't see it.
You know why you think that? Because you were a jock.
Yeah.
Do you remember the grassy knoll or the gazebo?
Yeah. I went to the gazebo. That's fucking where Steve and all of them.
But you didn't hang at the gazebo. That was a group.
But so yes, I played varsity football my freshman year. I was a Letterman jacket wearer my freshman year. I was a dork. I get it. But the John Hughes High School is what I had pictured in my head, and it didn't come through whenever I got to high school. It was like, it's totally different. It was kind of like a bum out.
The first thing I was extremely stoked on was the fucking street sweeper. When's the last time you had a street sweeper come through your neighborhood?
Like Thursday?
They haven't come through mine since I moved into my house in 2020.
You live in Independence, so.
He's looking at me like, come on, man. You going to let him say that?
I was stoked on the street sweeper because.
But did you notice how dingy everything looked like?
I moved into my
part of town.
I moved into my neighborhood in early 2020, and there's still leaves on the in the curb.
From 2020?
Probably from 2020.
Yeah, from my other neighbors.
We need a street sweeper. Yeah. Harry Dean Stanton as Jack, Andy's father.
Love that man.
He is a great. I mean, he's in a lot of movies.
Alien.
Legendary.
Alien.
He is legendary. He phoned in most of this performance, I think.
He
ad-libbed most of his lines.
Andy is parenting her father in this movie.
Oh, yeah.
James Spader, born to play the role.
Totally.
He's such a fucking prick.
James Spader plays Steph, by the way. Yeah. That sounds like a female name based on what we're used to.
Yeah.
But Steph is James Spader.
Like, yeah. Stefan.
He plays that kind of role so well.
Yes.
He's probably a sweetheart in real life because he's just always an asshole in movies. But
so anything else on this first part? Anybody? Anybody?
No.
I dig
the Pretty in Pink song when it kicks in.
Good tune.
I obviously, if you couldn't tell by the writing, Ducky's character, just looking at him, set off my bully instincts where I'm like, oh God, try a little harder, douche.
Oh my God.
look at me type stuff. Well, I don't hate it, but it kind of sets it off. I don't know.
I mean,
mine is more of like, it comes off as like this insecure kind of a dork who's trying everything.
And I'm going to bring that
Jiminy
up.
Jiminy fucking cricket and looking fuck.
And it seems like his entire, like everything that motivates him to me is an eye roll and irritating, and his character bothers me quite a bit. From the intro, then I'm sure that'll be a through line and a lot I might have to say. Who knows? Let's find out.
Well, let's find out, because moving on to the next scene, now it tracks the record store where Andy works. We meet her boss and owner of the record store, Iona, who is in her early 30s with her hair spiked. She's obviously no stick in the mud. We quickly see that Iona and Andy have a very informal and sisterly relationship. While the two women mind the store, Andy brings up the prom. She isn't sure about going. Even if someone asks her, she believes it's a stupid tradition. Iona argues that everyone should go to their prom just for the experience, and a lot of life is a stupid tradition. Iona chases off a young attempted shoplifter with a staple gun as Blaine. The apparent nice rich kid who has been secretly admiring Andy walks into the record store. Andy and Blaine trade flirty glances as Blaine shops the record aisles. As Iona loudly and comically handles a personal phone call, a smiling Blaine asks Andy about a record he clearly doesn't want, and she gives him a sarcastically good review of the bullshit record. Blaine laughs and decides to buy the record because of her advice. Andy responds with some quick wit, asking if he is paying with his American Express Platinum card, implying that she sees him as a rich, spoiled kid. Andy and Blaine trade flirty smiles and glances as they wrap up their transaction. Could a rich guy like Blaine really go for a poor girl like Andy? Could Andy see herself with someone who comes from such a privileged upbringing? I hated this scene. I think
there was a pretty good comic relief in this scene, though.
The kid?
Iona on the phone.
Fuck,
were you listening to the shit she was saying?
Yeah.
God.
Dude, Iona.
She's a great Annie Potts. As Iona is fucking awesome.
She's the saving grace.
She's got like Cyndi Lauper vibes, kind of, but with dark hair.
Yes.
Yeah.
Perfect. Like, that's a perfect example. And then like later on, like it gets even better. But
Like at one point, while Blaine and Andy are flirting, you hear her yell, "Every time you go to the John, you lose IQ points." And then Blaine looks at her and she holds the phone and goes, "It's Walter Mondale."
Yeah.
Dude, like crushing. But her whole phone call is full of crazy, chaotic yelling to clearly someone she must be dating. And it's so funny. Everything she's saying there is hilarious.
Well, it sounds like it's somebody that's at her house still or something like that. And it's just, I love that part of the scene, but the rest of the scene, like parody type of stuff with them looking at each other over the record aisles. And she's just like, hey, and he's like, hey. And it's just like,
it did feel kind of like a first time director. Like, hey, I need to make sure that people know that right. They're interested. And it's like, yeah, we got it. Because of the glances back and forth.
Did
they do
you
it
guys,
like three times.
This scene is full for my fellow punks of punk rock Easter eggs.
Okay.
We have a Sam Hain record visible in the background.
Okay.
We have stickers of Uniform Choice, the Subhumans, JFA, and Black Flag. And my favorite one, when they first show the back, the wall, you know, that there's shelving and then there's records on the
wall. This
is one
I believe I saw.
There's records on the wall. There's an orange and black cover that says Grimm on it. It's
nope,
the Grimm.
I didn't see that.
I didn't see
the Grimm was a LA area punk rock band that existed in this time frame that featured none other than Jordan Burns from Strung Out on drums long before he was in Strung Out.
I didn't know that. I didn't know that.
That is the Getting Revenge in America. It's a 12-inch EP, but the last time I watched this movie, I was unaware of the Grimm. They were kind of obscure, and so I found out about them just within the last few years. And so watching this and seeing that record was like, holy shit.
Yeah, that's fucking cool, actually.
So I messaged Jordan Burns on Instagram because like we talk on there sometimes, and I was like, hey, did you guys know that your record is in Pretty in Pink? He's like, yeah, we thought we were going to blow up from that. He's like, no.
That's awesome.
Yeah, pretty cool. This is, you know, it's cool to see little punk rock things in a movie, especially a movie this old.
Well, and I mean, it's rad because, you know, like it does have that kind of, with Andy Potts, with Iona in there, it kind of has that counterculture, like underground type of stuff. And it's Chicago. So
yeah, she's got her hair like in Liberty spikes.
Oh,
and
you know,
shit.
Ducky's crying in his room to fucking Morrissey tape. And just like what anybody does to Morrissey.
They're representing like underground music.
Yeah,
because Morrissey, I know, was a little more mean, but he was, which I know this technically it's a Smith's track, but Morrissey, totally.
Yeah,
yeah.
But you know, Psychedelic Furs are kind of on that new wave.
Yep.
You know, so it's a big,
yeah. So, do we have anything else to say about that little bit? I mean, that was a very quick scene versus the opening.
Totally.
I was stoked on that scene just because of all the punk rock shit. You know,
I thought it was funny when Iona shoots probably like an 11-year-old kid with a staple gun.
The kid was like 15. Come on.
He was definitely not 15.
Definitely
he
not.
Was like 11.
He was
maybe
pubescent, man.
I don't think so.
He got what he deserved, little prick.
Yeah. Yeah. Try and steal from the fucking, from the working man like that. Small business owners. Fuck you.
Chia. You know?
What? All right. Shrout, you're up.
Oh, man. Swing and a miss. We now see Andy at a local live music club with some friends. She is asking them what they think about dating rich people. Clearly, she wants to be reassured that it's no big deal. Meanwhile, Duckie waits for Andy outside the club, chatting with the doorman who won't let Duckie in because he isn't cool enough. Here we learn that Duckie has feelings for Andy and that the bouncer should let him in because Andy was inside. The bouncer reminds Duckie that Andy comes here all the time, knowing that Duckie never gets in. What does that say about Andy's feelings towards Duckie? Duckie, always in denial, dismisses the comment from the doorman as Andy comes out of the club. Duckie walks with Andy to her car asking for a ride home. Duckie makes uncomfortable comments the entire way home as his obsession with her is becoming more apparent. Andy casually ignores his advances as his normal joking, flirtatious comments are always met with an eye roll and a dismissive smile. She had put Duckie in the friend zone long before this night, so this was nothing new to her. Andy is more interested in the nice home she is passing as we are starting to see that maybe Andy does dream of finer things in life.
Okay, so a couple things on this scene. One is there's like a hidden little thing, but first of all, the doorman.
The Dice.
Dice Man. Andrew Dice Clay. Pretty much playing himself because he calls him the Dice Man at some point.
That's
and he's doing these. My wife didn't like reckon, you know, I had to like tell her, but she was like, the fuck is his deal?
Yeah.
Because he's doing the thing with his arms where he's like shooting his arms out to pull his sleeves up and stuff and reaching around his head
you
to grab his cigarettes
and
shit. It's so funny.
Did you notice Duckie call him sensitive?
No.
Andrew Dice Clay, sensitive?
That's not a thing.
That's not something
that's ever been said before.
Yeah, but it's tongue in cheek. That's the thing. He's not serious. He rules. I love that dude. And then also, did you notice at the table at the music club, that dude who's just sitting
who was sitting with them?
Yeah,
I did.
You did.
I did.
And do you know why he's sitting there, first of all?
Because
in real life, he was dating Molly Ringwald.
Who is this?
That's right. That's right. I did
the
read
only
that.
Male that was sitting at this table.
Oh, Andy doesn't know.
I don't know. No. I guess I didn't pick up on
you
it.
You wouldn't recognize him.
Let me tell you, there's a guy named Frank Zappa, okay? He had a kid.
That's Dweezil Zappa.
Dweezil.
Dweezil.
Dweezil Zappa.
Dweezil? That's what you call him?
Sure.
Dweezil Zappa.
D-W-Z. I'm an English major and I can't fucking...
Hey, let me ask you a question. Does this Dweezil Zappa?
Dweezil.
Dweezil Zappa was there too.
Hold on. We should... You say, keep saying, I'm an English major, I'm a badass.
Dweezil.
But Dweezil.
Dweezil.
Dweezil. No, Dweezil. At first you were saying
he's saying Dweezil.
I really
putting the W after the Z.
Hey, let me ask you another question.
Did you guys know who the band was that was performing in the club?
I do.
It's Creed.
It's the Rave Ups.
Do you know the song they're playing? They're playing Rave Up, Shut Up. Is that a real band?
Does Dweezil turn?
No, I'm pretty sure they're a real band.
They're a real band. The Rave Ups.
I thought it was a band playing a band called the Rave Ups. Kind of like how the O'Neaters had to play
a band
Captain Geach and the Shrimp Shack Shooters.
Yep. Just like that.
What is that from?
Jesus thing Christ. You do.
Come on, man.
The Wonders get in the
I've
movie.
Never seen that.
You've never seen that thing you do?
No.
Oh my God.
You motherfucker.
Oh, I hope to God it gets spun today.
Is it too late to just switch the movie to that thing you do? I'm just joking. But dude, so good. Anyway, no, but this one, I did appreciate how it's this club. And then the conversation with Duckie and Dice Man, where he's just like, yo, kid, you come here every week and she knows you don't get in and she still comes here. You know, like maybe you should find a chick who's into you.
I remember this scene back watching it when I was like in high school or something like that. And it was one of those young, dumb thoughts of like, that's what you got to do to win the girl. Like, just I'm going to continue.
That's the thing.
Now it's
a fucking, they call it a sex pest or some shit like that, where he just won't leave her alone. This motherfucker is creeping in every scene of this movie.
Yes, exactly.
Every fucking scene.
And
he shows a stupid little face. I get so annoyed by it. I'm like, dude, you are way over the line. Maybe it's because I have a daughter. And if anybody like stalked my daughter at this point, I would have shit to say. I'd be like, yo, man. You ride by this house one more time on that bicycle, I'm going to fucking throw a goddamn broom in your spokes.
Well, I mean, I don't know that he's necessarily stalking you because they're best friends.
I know, but he's just, he's laying it on so goddamn thick.
You don't realize when you're 16 years old that you're doing this to a girl, probably.
Right.
I see that.
Men now. It's like, if somebody says no, you just, fuck it. I'm done then.
I'm sure part of Duckie was in me at different times of life. Maybe that's why I react to it so much.
That's
the point, is it like, when I see it, I'm like, oh, ooh.
See, and that's why, like,
cringe
like,
status.
When I was in high school, I remember this scene. I was like, this is what you need to do. And that's what you see kids now trying to do the same thing, but on TikTok or something like that. It's like, dude, back the fuck off type of thing. So, and that's what that's what the Dice is trying to tell him.
Yeah, he's just being like, yo, like, you should go after chicks that are into you. She's not into you. And he's just like, it doesn't matter. I'm still just going to follow her everywhere
she goes.
Are
we really going to accuse the Dice Man of trying to do something that's not rapey?
It feels not right saying that, but that's exactly what happened.
God, I feel like I'm on Twitter. You guys don't even know the guy. He rules. He's a nice guy. All right. Do you guys have anything to say about that Andrew Dice Clay scene from the Dice Man?
No. Nope, not a thing. Not a single thing.
Not even how creepy Duckie is. Even the comments he's making in the fucking car, God. He just keeps saying like borderline creepy shit. Like, she was like, oh, isn't that house beautiful? And he says something like, well, if you want to see beauty, why don't you look in the mirror?
I didn't.
God, you little twerp.
I hate John Cryer so much. Like, I barely listened to what he said. It was honestly... like the Peanuts moms, wah, 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 wah. Like that. It was like,
The thing is the character is just,
you want to push him?
He's an insecure kid who's in love with his best friend. You know what I mean?
And so he needs to be pushed into a pool with his clothes on by a bully.
That may be the case, but I think that Duckie is just he's an insecure kid who's in love with his best friend. And so he says some cringy shit and he says things that may be kind of creepy if the context were a little different. I don't think it's creepy because they know each other so well.
I think it's creepy because they know each other so well. Like he knows that she's not into him.
Yeah, the creepy is like maybe the wrong word, but it is one of those things where it's coming across like ultra desperate.
Yeah.
I don't know. But I just have a lot of feelings every time we see them on screen because it's the entire movie.
This sort of situation though, where, and it's usually the dude who's in love with his friend that's a girl and she's not feeling it. That's that kind of situation is in so many like TV shows and so many movies.
Totally.
Especially back in that time period, yeah. 80s and 90s. So it's not an unheard of idea. And I think that's, you know,
I don't know.
That's
now. I think the age thing does play into it for sure.
I think looking at it now, it's been played out. Back in the 80s, it was totally different. It was unique. Now, I think looking at it with, you know, what are we, 30 years, 35 years since it was made, we're looking at it with a different lens than what we ever had than we did before.
It's probably true because I don't think people saw it, and I can't not see it through this like lens of like,
it's absolute cringe. Right,
let now. Her breathe, dude.
Right,
come on.
And but
like you're making yourself look like a pathetic loser the whole time. I'm just, I don't know. There's a scene later where it almost seems like he has a shot, but it's like, get some fucking balls, man.
Jim, I actually have
get
something
some
about
fucking
that.
Get balls, man.
I have something about that.
All right. The next day, Andy is studying on a computer at the library. Suddenly, her computer screen is taken over by a mysterious person. A question pops up on her screen, asking if she would like to chat. Assuming it's Duckie, she tells the anonymous person that she is too busy with her studies. The screen informs her that Duckie isn't the one who is her secret admirer. Now intrigued, Andy types out questions of her own to figure out the identity of the mystery typer. The computer responds with a picture of Blaine. Andy is excited. She stands from a computer to see Blaine in the library on another computer. They lock eyes and smile. Andy is really beginning to like Blaine. Meanwhile, Duckie is at Andy's house talking to Andy's father, Jack, about his feelings for Andy. Duckie lays out a big vision of the long-term plans he has for his eventual marriage to Andy. Jack relates to the young love that Duckie is feeling. Jack remembers feeling that way about Andy's mother before she left the family 3 years ago, spinning Jack into a depression he still can't recover from. Jack imparts his wisdom to Duckie that you can love a woman, but it doesn't mean she's going to love you back, but you still try.
This was the thing that kind of made Duckie's quest, I guess, for Andy, I think, feel verified, you know?
Like, yeah, I just think where she's like, yeah, oh, well, I'm gonna take care of her forever. You don't have to worry about that. If something were to happen to you, I'm gonna marry her. And even the dad's like kind of laughing, like,
okay,
you know, like naive kid, you know.
When he's sitting there talking with him the entire time, I don't remember this scene until I watched it this time. So I guess this is one I never saw. It just made me almost be like, Henry Dean Stanton, come on, like smack some sense into this kid. But at the same time, he's still madly in love with the woman who left him. So Henry Dean Stanton is in the same place as Duckie is, unfortunately. Yes, you're Harry Shrout. Shrout Harry. Harry Shrout.
No, his name is Harry Dean Stanton.
You keep calling him Henry. What the fuck?
That's yeah. Whatever.
Just think about
whatever.
He was in Aliens.
We find out here that's, you know, at the beginning of the movie, she's like taking care of her dad. And you're like, what's going on with this guy? Well, this is the scene that they reveal. He's fucking heartbroken.
Right.
His wife.
Ever since his wife left him, he's never picked up the pieces.
Dude is fucking wrecked over losing the love of his life, basically. And he's still like in love with her and she's gone. So,
now, I do want to say...
I like that they sort of answer any questions you had about him at the beginning.
It explains his depression and the hole he's in.
One thing I do want to say there, it's only been 3 years. This was the love of his life, gave him...
I know, and she's in the formative years of her life. You'd be right. Like, hold on, so you were like 15 when your mom left? That's fucked up.
14 or 15, like when her mom
left.
How
do you feel about that, Andy? That's fucked up.
Right.
You know?
But
she has like a picture of her by the bed, and they talk about her as if she's dead.
Right. And I thought she was until it turned like, you know,
she's just off probably doing drugs somewhere or something.
I got a question about the fucking computer screen takeover by Blaine.
I'm pissed about this.
This is not fucking accurate at all.
No, that was not.
Do you know how hard back then that? Oh,
and how long that picture would have taken to load would have been hours, if not days.
No, because
no joke.
No. Nope. If you're talking about it like
86, she didn't have a fucking cable modem.
We were using Apple IIs at 86 by Number Munchers and William Bryant.
It's not. It wasn't internet. That was an internal server.
Doesn't matter. The picture loading wouldn't happen. Didn't have the RAM on those fucking things. So Blaine had a picture of himself loaded on that local network already?
Yeah, he would have had to.
How did he do that?
I don't know. I'm a LAMP stack developer. I like, I'm on PHP.
All right. Well, I'm on PCP SQL. When I stack LAMPs too. But the way, this movie that we're talking about is they invented the goddamn internet.
No, they didn't. That's an intern. Like, you've had computers talk to each other for decades. Not decades. I'm sorry. For years at this point.
I was playing Number Munchers in 86. I know.
Yep.
Yeah. And Shrout couldn't send me a picture of myself on an impulse when I was playing Number Munchers or Oregon Trail.
Yeah, Oregon Trail. Yep.
On that same Oregon Trail computer, you could have sent an instant message to another teacher. Yeah, turn your phone off. You could have sent you could have sent a message to somebody else on that internal network. That's how those things work.
I didn't know how to do it, and neither did Molly Ringwald.
No, Molly Ringwald did, but Andy Dean Stanton did.
You're not even trying to learn the names.
Nope.
My guess.
But yeah, Andrew McCarthy could have learned that stuff. I mean, he's a rich kid. He could have got a computer camp. Like, that's a rich kid thing.
How did he get her picture loaded in that shit?
Andy's trying to get us. He's trying to get us. Should go on that whole suspension of disbelief thing.
Yeah, and like, I'm okay with it. Like, I did that.
I actually put one of my things is computers are magic. Quote, like, that's, you can't do that. You could not.
Why have you been naysaying the same shit that you wrote down on your notes?
I'm just saying it is possible. You guys are saying it was impossible at that time. I'm saying it was possible. I'm saying it's stupid, but like
fucking Al Gore.
I invented the internet, not him.
It was possible for people who worked for like a fucking computer company, right. Maybe.
But he was rich.
It wasn't being Blaine done in schools.
Rich. Blaine was rich. He could have gone to computer camp. That's all I'm saying. He could have done it, but the way that they make it, it's like computers are magic. Fuck you.
No, I saw the bonus scene where he didn't go to computer camp.
Oh, they couldn't afford it? Or they took it to space camp instead?
Also, those computers in that school weren't on a network, bud.
Yes, they were.
They were plugged in each individually into an outlet, and that's it.
That's right.
It wasn't like an Ethernet cable connecting them all.
There wasn't...
Andy, there wasn't Wi-Fi. You're full of shit. They were Bluetooth in each other's Blackberries. That's what you think.
That's exactly what was going on. So Andy, now back at work, casually tries on some newly stocked sunglasses as Blaine walks in the store. Blaine says with a grin that he would like to find a different record because the last one was too hip. And at this point, it's obvious that he only comes to talk to Andy. As Andy makes some fake recommendations for some more music that Blaine wouldn't like, their banter is interrupted by the sound of the back door alarm. Andy begs Blaine to stay as she rushes to the back to find Duckie, who has opened the back door, setting off the alarm. Obviously, Duckie had been spying on Andy's conversation. As Andy and Duckie argue in the back about Duckie's jealous, cock-blocking behavior, rich asshole Steph walks in the record store and asks Blaine what he's doing there. Blaine, feeling self-conscious about his interest in a lower-class woman, tells Steph he is just shopping for records. Steph reminds Blaine of their trap shooting plans, and the men leave the store before Andy can get rid of Duckie. Feeling sad after work because her conversation with Blaine was cut short, Andy arrives at home and checks her answering machine, hoping Blaine is called. But alas, she's only received several messages, all from an obsessed Duckie. Just then her phone rings. She snatches up the phone only to hear Ducky's voice. She angrily tells him that she will talk to him tomorrow before hanging up the phone in frustration. At this point, this is what I said. This is the only thing I had to say about Duckie. Fuck Duckie.
Right?
That dude is like, that is the obsession. Like, fuck off.
These message machines, when you hear it, they're like every 8 minutes or every three minutes. He's like, hey, just call him again.
7:32.
Like, that was like five messages in the span of like 20 some minutes.
I mean, this was a short scene, But again, it's just reinforcing the annoyance of Duckie, and it
his cock blocking in this whole thing is obnoxious in this scene.
See, and I didn't realize it was until I read the script. I was like, oh shit, it was hit like cock blocking. I didn't did it show him like looking in? Because I guess I just didn't see that.
No,
they never show it, but right as they're getting like, you know, to know each other.
Right.
Yeah, but he was like, I saw you talking to your friend and I didn't want to interrupt, which is another one of those like creepy little things to say where he's trying to manipulate with his bullshit little games. I mean, there's just not a lot of redeeming. I'm glad Shrout sees the good side in Duckie and reminds me that he's like a version of like a 16-year-old who doesn't know shit. Because I really just see this little creep who needs his ass whooped. And I'm like, no. Remember, the character's like 16. I'm seeing like, to me, John Cryer's probably in his 20s. And I'm just like, God, this fucking dude.
He's a pest and a nuisance, but he's not dangerous.
Correct.
Yes. Is what I'm getting at. Yes. Yeah. He's not like, you know.
Like with this one, that was the main thing I see is Duckie and the message machine. And, you know, obviously her and Blaine are really hitting it off.
It's called an answering machine. It's not a message machine.
Oh, is that what it's called? They're leaving answers on there. I'm sorry. Fucking whack. But so anyway, on this message machine that they're leaving the answers on, it's all Duckie, and he just fills up the message machine with his answers. And then like, but you know, at the record store when Blaine and Andy are talking, and he's just like, yeah, I don't know, that last one, it's a little too hip.
Right.
And he was, but what we didn't even comment that first record he bought was just some like random cheesy ass
Gary white, McDonald or something some like that.
Bullshit where you're like, what the which, fuck is this?
By the way, RIP Burt Bacharach. I thought it was something like that.
You know, this time
he
around,
just died.
I know he did. I just love that it was just some lame ass white guy. You're like, oh yeah, that reminds me, Burt Bacharach. I'm like, it's such a touching tribute.
The next time around, she even mentions Lionel Richie, like that's a bad thing. And I'm like, dude. Oh, you did not.
Yeah, no. Yeah, she was totally making fun of him.
Oh,
dude. Like,
but like a rich white guy, like dance music. Cause remember, she was too cool for Lionel Richie, which I think that time
with the Smiths,
with the music that we were listening to, we probably would have, he would have been like Bieber of his time. I don't think we would have been like, whatever, dude, that's for like lamos.
She was into Sunny Day. He was into Creed. Not going to work.
It's a new morning at Andy's house. We see her father, Jack, singing as he is up early cooking breakfast. He informs his daughter that he has found a job. An excited Andy heads to school, where we see her sitting alone among the other poor students between classes. Poor students?
Yep.
Oh. Blaine uncomfortably enters the outdoor area made up of mostly freaks, burners, and losers and approaches Andy. He asks her on her first official date on Friday night. Andy excitedly accepts but insists he must pick her up at work and not at home. As Blaine walks to class, he is approached by turbo douche Steph, who had just seen him speaking with Andy. Steph informs Blaine that it isn't a good look for him to be associating with mutant poor people. Blaine doesn't seem as quick to judge Andy. Later that night, Andy is helping Duckie study in her room. Duckie seems uninterested in learning the material, and the two begin to talk about their 8-year friendship. After high school, they won't see each other as much. As Andy goes to the kitchen to get some drinks, Duckie lays in Andy's bed and begins talking to himself. He loves Andy. He needs to find a way to tell her before it's too late. He then begins singing about love into Andy's hairbrush as she listens through the vents and laughs. Just as Duckie is summoning the courage to finally say it, Andy walks back into the room with their drinks. Duckie panics and immediately has second thoughts. He quickly makes an excuse about needing to learn the material on his own and leaves, confusing Andy. Why are they like 18-year-old kids drinking juice boxes, by the way?
I know. He even keeps making like references like, well, hey, if you're going to drink and drive, at least you're riding a bike or something. I'm like, what are you doing?
You actually just ruined my favorite quote of the whole movie.
What's that?
Oh, good.
When he says, hey, drinking and driving don't mix. That's why I ride a bike.
That's your favorite quote of the movie?
Yeah,
but
it's great.
That does no, it isn't. Objectively, it isn't.
No, that's like quote.
That's not even clever. It's not funny.
It's not clever.
It doesn't bite.
It's definitely clever.
It's got too no long. Balls. It's got nothing. I don't like it at all. I like the I like the appliance one better.
I'm just kidding. So, all right. But did you guys notice
that as soon as Andy left and Duckie is there all alone, his act breaks. He has a different pace with his words and everything like that. He, so I think the flamboyant big peacocking, as you all, you like to say, Jason, is a complete front.
Yeah, maybe. And she seemed, I don't know. She seemed like
she seemed almost taken by it.
Almost flirting back a little bit.
Right.
You know, she did say something like, hey, you know, when high school's over and, you know, we're not going to see each other every day, I hope you're going to be okay. Because basically she's like saying, hey, you're like lean on me for everything.
Right.
And I'm not always going to be here. But he doesn't take a shot. He even like lays back in the bed. We're like, oh, man, I need to tell her. I need to tell her. When she comes back in the room, he's just like, oh, I better go.
Right.
I'm like, oh, you.
She can't
coward.
Like she
it's
had
so hard to do. I'm going to be vulnerable for a second. So
sure.
You guys are going to make fun of me right now.
Nah. I definitely will.
This whole scene between Andy and Duckie in her bedroom.
Uh-huh.
It's extremely similar to my experience when I was in high school with the person that.
I've had
unrequited love, right?
I've had experiences similar, though. I know what you're talking about.
And what are you talking about?
So many nights in her bedroom, just like this one, where, you know, I was in love with her, and she didn't know in the beginning, and then when she did, she didn't feel the same way when she knew that I felt that way, and it was torturous for me sometimes. Like,
yeah,
he decides I just got to get out of here because he can't handle it. And I've been there, and. I remember like wanting to tell her and being so fucking terrified to tell her.
Right.
So I get that whole scene. It fucking hits close to home for me. Probably for a lot of people.
Yeah. No, me too. Yeah. I have my version of it. Like,
yeah, I think everybody.
I had a crush on this girl who was a mega babe. I was, you know, young, probably eighth, ninth grade, something like that. And I spent the night at her house and we slept together on the same couch. I didn't make a move. Then like probably, I don't know, later in our friendship, we're in her room and she's like, hey, I'm just going to change real quick. Gets down to her bra and panties, smoking hot. I don't make a move. Those are things that I used to kick myself about. Like, dude, what the fuck?
Yeah.
But, you know, now, you know, I'm an older guy. It's all different. But back then I'm like,
yeah, if you would
I can relate to this shit. Like not making the move when, even when the woman was like being a lot more like, yo, you should have. Like I couldn't have made it any more clear. Even though they made it clear, there's something in you that's like, I can't do it. Didn't know how to begin. I get it.
I remember girls.
I think that's what I hate about Duckie is maybe you see a little bit of yourself and it's the way he goes about it though.
Right.
Where I'm just like, oh, it's such like.
No, I just think he's a douchebag.
It's total beta behavior.
I remember a girl I had a crush on in high school. We ran into each other years later and she even said, I had such a crush on you. It was like, you look back and you're like, fuck.
Right.
Like, right. Really?
Yep.
Yeah. And you're like,
had a few of those. Too.
Yeah. You want to be like, well, what about now?
Like, yeah. No, like
the hot cheerleader who's like, I used to have a crush on you. You're like, no, you didn't. What the fuck? Really?
What? You want to be like, what? You want to be like, that's funny because I don't even remember going to school with you.
No. Yeah. You want to nag them? That's what
back.
You want to
yeah,
do?
Give it back.
Yeah. Totally.
Yeah, that
no,
was
like, no, like I feel Duckie in this scene. This is the one scene that I'm just like, God damn it, Duckie. Like I actually kind of feel for him on that.
And I think what it is I understand what they're doing with the character and I'm cool with that, but maybe it's the way John Cryer plays him. Cause I know we will get into it about the other options for the character and all that stuff, but there is just something. So it's nails on a chalkboard for most of the movie with this character and me.
Right.
I don't know why.
Right. I got a few things to say about this scene other than the, you know, the vulnerable getting real
strong.
Jack smoking a cigarette while he cooks the breakfast. Such an 80s thing and so gross.
We talked about it last week with Mr. Mom.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah, a lot of these like John Hughes movies.
Smoking.
The Grand Inquisition from Steph. James Spader.
Oh, God.
Fuck. What a fucking snob.
I hate.
But he plays it well.
He does.
Spader's a good actor.
Spader's amazing.
And then the whole the courtyard scene with all the skaters, punks, goths, weirdos, freaks, whatever. That's what our grassy knoll was. So, like, that would have been our spot out there.
Right.
The next day, we see Andy in gym class where another incident with the blonde rich bitches forces Andy to visit her guidance counselor. About the treatment disparity between the rich kids and poor kids. After the meeting, Andy is immediately hounded by Duckie. He wants to cheer her up by taking her out. She repeatedly and forcefully turns Ducky's advances down and angrily heads back to class as Duckie gets his ass kicked by a couple of rich bullies before throwing him into a women's bathroom. Later that evening, we see a frustrated Andy at work helping Iona with some after-hours accounting. It's Friday night, and Blaine was supposed to pick Andy up at closing time. Iona puts on an Otis Redding record, pissing off her retail neighbor, as Duckie bursts through the doors lip-syncing the song along with some playful dancing around the record store. Andy and Iona just sit and watch with confusion until Duckie finishes his routine. Unamused, the women begin to talk about Ducky's stalker-like behavior as if he wasn't there. Andy thinks she has been stood up and is not in the mood for Ducky's bullshit. Just as Andy is about to give up on Blaine, he shows up in front of the store. Now Duckie realizes that the love of his life is about to officially go on a date with another man. Iona goes to let Blaine in as Andy talks to Duckie in the back of the store to let him down easy. Duckie responds with anger and insists that Blaine isn't good enough for her. Duckie unleashes an ultimatum that he won't like her anymore or be there for her anymore if she goes on the date. Andy is offended that he would hold their friendship over her like that. Duckie leaves angrily, and Andy heads out to meet Blaine for their date.
Okay, real quick. Did anybody notice who was one of the friends in the gym class?
Gina Gershon. She has not aged.
She looks
since
so
then.
Good. She is credited as girlfriend. She didn't even have a name of that.
Huh.
Yeah. But can we also talk about Ducky's racist voice in the bathroom? Did you guys notice that?
Didn't notice what? What happened?
He was like, oh, I don't like it. Like his like almost like big black woman voice type of thing like that. It was
you
real
see,
bad. There's a hard F-bomb drop in there too.
I think it's a fine line.
I don't know. John Cryer's never been cool. And he
oh,
never
is
will.
That the scene where... No, that's not that scene.
What scene?
Never mind. Talked about the F-bomb drop. There was one that actually me and my wife start dying laughing.
But yeah, so I mean like the pushing him in the lock or in the bathroom and stuff like that. That
well, yeah, the when they actually got to the women's bathroom, I was just like, rolling my eyes. Yeah. He called the tampon machine a candy machine or some shit like that. It kind of, you know, made you giggle.
We ain't got none of this over in our bathroom. Like, Shroud, you look like you have just something to say about all of this.
I just, the fucking bullies that they, like the rich bros that beat him up, or they didn't even show him really beating him up. He just gets thrown in the bathroom.
Right.
They got to find some tougher looking people.
Right.
Dude, it was the 80s.
Rich
Nobody
bros are
then.
Never tough looking.
No.
The stereotypical jock in a movie is not, it's the least intimidating person
like
in
this
the
guy right
world.
Here.
Yeah.
Back, I remember like back then in the 80s, they're like all of the tough guys, they didn't have, like they weren't cut like they are now. Like they're just kind of just there. Like they were tough because the script told them that they were tough.
Yeah, you're right. They'd find
yeah
guys who look a certain way. And
they're like,
Try a Little Tenderness by Otis Redding.
Dude,
my dad,
killer jam.
My dad would karaoke that song and just have the fucking place erupting afterwards. So
I watched.
Dope.
Shout out to Howard
Shrout.
Yeah,
I miss him.
Duckie just murdering the lip sync to it and everything like that. I had to just kind of like look away. I think I just looked at my phone while the song went on. I knew what was going on.
I actually think he did all right in this scene. It was the one scene where I was like.
I think it was,
okay. All right. He's like, he really committed to the bit. I'm trying to be honest and I'm trying to give him a little bit because he committed. I felt like the scene, his character was, this was probably the best he did in the movie for me because everything else was unwatchable.
Is it really unwatchable? I mean, the actor did a good job playing the character, but
I know. I think
even if he's crazy,
I don't think the character was supposed to be as annoying.
It's just like you, the cringe continues to grow. With this
to me, this was
shit.
To me this scene was like a relief from that.
See, like,
I don't know.
To me, it was just like fuck off, dude.
The character's behavior.
Too long. Again,
the character's behavior comes in. He comes in, and his behavior is a bit off-putting because, again, here's fucking Duckie in the scene. No one invited him, but of course he shows up in the fucking scene. He shows up in every scene, but this was the one where he didn't come in and immediately be like, "Hey." You want to see my dick or whatever the fuck, you know?
I do remember.
Of course,
he said
he's not that forward, but you know, the point is, Like it was, he kind of was being funny.
Right.
And at least I can relate to that. That was my way of like flirting and getting friend zoned when I was like a young man, was at least I was going to try to be fucking funny. Like he was just doing like manipulative, cringy shit.
Right.
Like really needy.
Well, and I see where you're going with that. Like he does his lip sync and it, like to the Otis Redding and everything like that. But I do love at the end of it. I do remember when you said this quote earlier. It was like, his name is Blaine. Like that's here. I do.
That was in the scene. Where it was on the scene. Back.
Yeah. Like when they're in the back having their friend conversation and everything.
Like I'm going to go on a date with Blaine. He's like,
his name is Blaine.
He goes, Blaine. Blaine's not a name. It's a major appliance. Yeah. Or whatever.
Yeah. It's like, it's, I've been in that situation when you have that girlfriend that's like, you've had a crush on forever. And then all of a sudden she's like, oh, I'm going on this date with this guy. And you're like, but he's such a douche. Like,
and your heart sinks to the floor.
You're like,
great.
And you do the fucking Charlie Brown walk back to home Michael from Arrested Development, little kid, Michael Scott. That's it. Michael Scott
from Arrested Development. No, Bluth.
Michael Bluth, like little Bluth, little Michael Bluth from,
George Michael.
Yeah, Bluth. George Michael. And so whenever he's walking back, like, so you like, you know, you have that just feeling that just complete defeated feeling. That was the only time when I felt for Duckie, because he's saying the things that I could never say whenever that my crush is going out with a guy.
Yeah, but he does say things like, if you go out on that date, I'm not going to like you anymore.
Right. No.
You know, shit like that where I'm like,
that's the douche stuff. That is the douche stuff.
It kind of goes back to that. Like, I know, I guess that's what it's the balance. I understand how the character feels and like what he's going through, but his way of going about it is objectively like he's at that stage of like his teen years where he's got to learn. He's got to learn like, this is not going to get the woman.
Yeah, it's fine to decide not to be her friend anymore, but you don't say that to her. Right. You're just like, you just disappear. And
right.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah.
Like you let her, you don't just be like, if you,
in today's terms,
you need to keep like leading me on, but you also can't like find happiness with somebody else.
Right. No, like you can't, you can't go out and say it and just be like, if you do this, I'm not going to be your, like, fuck off, dude. Like that's going to be like, all right, make her just.
Right. Absolutely. It would definitely push her away.
Yeah.
Hey, did you guys notice at the beginning of the scene in the gym class where her friend is just smoking a cigarette gym class?
I put
like inside the gym.
The one that died from asthma, by the way.
Yeah, but she's smoking in the whole movie.
Yeah,
didn't smoke in real life. Like her character smoking in this movie,
like John Travolta,
exacerbated her asthma and killed her.
Maybe she was a smoker in real life, and they were just like, she doesn't stop smoking, so she's just gonna smoke in character too.
Maybe, yeah.
One thing about this scene. You guys got anything else? Because I got something real special.
No.
I don't think so.
Hit us with it, sir.
Okay. You remember back at the bar, in the first time they went into the bar or the club, we had old Simon played by...
Dweezy.
Dweezil. Yeah. Dweezil Zappa.
Yeah. Dweezil.
In this scene, part of this scene that we just talked about, when they're in the record store, there's a Dweezil Zappa record.
Oh.
Over Andy's shoulder. Okay.
Of course.
Jesus Christ, man.
How do they explain Simon's existence if Dweezil Zappa exists in that universe?
I don't know.
Dweezil Zappa look like in this universe?
Here's a little brain muster
must
for
look
you.
Identical to Simon.
He was the act after Creed that was playing when they were in the scene, and that's where
Creed?
Yeah, Creed was playing in there.
He just keeps bringing it back to Creed because he is a huge fan.
I'm a huge fan.
He also likes Kid Rock. What a loser.
Well, I just heard the news today.
Isn't that live? No. Oh,
that was Creed.
That was Creed.
Live is lightning crashes and old mother dad.
Angel opens her eyes.
He does run all over the place on the word eyes.
That's true.
I'm just joking. But we used to fucking love that.
You said I'm just joking.
No.
I'm just joking. He doesn't actually really sing like that.
He actually does do that.
He really does, though.
Yeah. But so he was hanging out with Iona because he wanted to get his record in her shop So she was hanging. He was hanging out with her at this. At the.
And Simon was just an incognito name.
Iona wasn't there that first night.
No, that's who she was having drinks with.
Yeah.
No, it wasn't. That first night, it was the fucking cigarette smoker girl. That first night when Dweezil was there.
I thought Iona was there.
Oh, I don't know.
No, Iona's there with Duckie later.
I'm gonna have to rewatch this.
Yeah, you should spend your time doing that.
This is better than fucking Mr. Mom. Come on.
It is. I might agree. Yeah. No, I don't know.
This movie isn't bad.
I like Michael Keaton more.
I do like Michael Keaton more. I like Molly Ringwald a lot better than Michael Keaton. She has a lot less hair. So Andy and Blaine's date is off to an awkward start after the scene with Duckie. Blaine wants to bring Andy to a party at his friend's house, but she doesn't like the idea of partying with the rich kids who always look down on her. Blaine insists that his friends will be welcoming, and she reluctantly agrees to go to the party. Soon after arriving, Andy is made fun of and mocked by several different people. Blaine tries to comfort her by offering a more quiet place to talk upstairs, but Andy questions Blaine's motives. Blaine ultimately convinces her that going upstairs is better than staying downstairs with a bunch of assholes. While looking for a room to occupy upstairs, Andy and Blaine stumble upon a wasted Steph in a room with one of the blonde bitches from school. After Steph and his date trash on Blaine and Andy, the two finally decide to leave the party. Andy takes Blaine to her favorite hangout, the Live Music Club, and they find Duckie and Iona hanging out at a table near the front. Duckie was finally able to get in because Iona said he was her son. Blaine goes to the bar to get some drinks while Andy joins her friends. At the table, Duckie gives Andy the cold shoulder as Iona and Andy talk about Ducky's mopey behavior. As Blaine rejoins the group, Ducky's behavior becomes more aggressive and forcing Andy to snap angrily at Duckie. Andy and Blaine leave as Duckie makes one last attempt at making Andy jealous by rape kissing Iona in front of her. However, it doesn't work. Blaine isn't ready to end the night, but Andy has to get up early. He offers to take her home, but she doesn't want Blaine to see where she lives. Eventually, she allows Blaine to take her home, and when they arrive, Blaine, proving he doesn't care about the size of her house, asks her to prom. Andy immediately starts to kiss Blaine. She's in love. Andy enters her house and shares her exciting news with her father. She is feeling insecure about their differences, but her father encourages her that love is worth it. One fucking kiss, they're in love. Are you fucking serious?
I think she's just in love with, because that was her whole big thing, is like, I can't let him see where I live. And the second he sees where she lives and still says, hey, I want to take you to prom, like still shows her that he likes her, she's all in. Now she's like, because it was a defense mechanism the whole time.
Right.
The reason she didn't like fully like, yeah, I don't know, but he's rich. Well, when he said, yeah, I'm rich, but I don't give a fuck if you're poor, she's like, oh my God, I love him so much.
Well, see,
that's what it felt like.
I get it. It's she's 16, 17, whatever.
Yeah.
And like, it.
Did you guys notice how terrible their kiss was?
Yes.
Yeah.
What the like, fuck?
They got no chemistry, those two.
Yeah, I mean, more chemistry than fucking Duckie.
Seriously, that kiss was fucking terrible. Like,
it was.
They both look like they'd never kissed anybody before.
I know. Yeah. It doesn't feel good in this, like the two, Andrew McCarthy and Andy McDowell or whatever the fuck her name is, fucking Molly Ringwald. They don't fit in this movie together. It doesn't ever fit in my head.
I agree.
Yeah. I'm so much less bothered by them than I would be the idea of Duckie and Molly Ringwald.
Did you guys pick up on Iona talking about Duckie? She goes, he's not going to ride his bike past your house anymore.
Exactly. Because Ducky's so fucking hurt and he's been talking all this shit.
And he's giving her the silent treatment and she's 3 feet away, not even 3 feet away. Like she's 7 inches away. It's just like, dude, come on. Like just fucking grow up, dude.
Annoying. There's a couple of parts in this scene that we, one when they're at the bar and she's pissed off at Duckie. And I'm just quoting what she said, everybody.
Okay.
So, you know, don't take away my Twitter. But she calls him a retarded little dwarf. So
damn, that's brutal. Did you guys notice when Blaine asked Annie if she wanted to go home and change?
Yes.
And that was how, that was why I worded it that the date was off to an awkward start.
So disappointing.
Dude.
Like,
because she had changed up there and got ready for the date at the record store.
She was looking so good. And he was like, I am ready. Like,
and she felt, did you see the look on her face? She was like so bummed. I was yes. Like, oh my God. No, what a shithead.
There's one more quote that he says that gets it off to an awkward start because he's like, you want to go to a party at my friend's house? And she's like, no. And then he says, like, well, we can go hang out with your friends and crawl under a rock.
Yeah.
Or something like that.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
And that's where I'm like, God damn, dude.
Dude.
Like, God, Duckie's making you look like a fucking...
Dude, like, it is so rough. The dude that you love, like, that is in love with you is ruining the, like, you picking him up, picking her up, sorry. And then, like, you say the one of the worst things you can say to somebody, to a girl, do you want to go home and change? Like, that's like, I'm done.
And I felt like he knew.
Yeah.
Like, he was just being an asshole. Yeah. He was judging the way she looked.
Yeah. It was a rough date the whole way through. And then that's why at the end, and he's like, do you want to go to prom? Those five words were the only thing to make her fall in love with him. Like, that was the only good thing of the entire night.
Well, did you also notice when their date
started?
That's
way more than five words.
Do you want to go to prom? Seven. Five. Five and seven are the same number. You guys didn't know that? I'm on math subreddits.
Did you know that when this date started, did you see the part where, like, it's raining and Duckie is sitting in the rain sulking?
No.
What a bitch.
Oh, I did.
Wait, is this where he's sitting in his room listening to...
No, this is when he's, like, sitting, like, on the newspaper stands on the side of a restaurant and it starts to rain and he's just sitting there, like, outside.
I didn't. But what I did notice was when they were at the fucking house with the party.
Yep.
And Blaine picks up the bag of pretzels with his mouth.
No.
Hey, I actually laughed out loud at that. He like wasn't using his hands, so he like picked up the bag of pretzels with his mouth.
I saw that. He's like, look, I'll keep my hands to myself.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Because he was trying to prove to her that he wasn't like all about that.
Yeah.
But when they go upstairs and see Steph, who had just like hooked up with that blonde chick.
Right.
And she comes out.
Isn't that his girlfriend or something like that?
That's like Steph's girlfriend that he's like hanging out with. And they're all kind of like talking shit like, oh, you know, because nobody likes Molly Ringwald. She's poor. And then there's a, and then also she says to Molly Ringwald's character, the bitchy blonde girl, she goes, here's a girl from my calculus class. And she and then Molly Ringwald corrects her and goes, Jim. And she goes, your name's Jim?
Dude, like, that I'm shit sorry, was funny. But that girl is not as bad as, like, she's trying to make, like, the movie's trying to make her out to be, like, this total bitch. Like, fucking Regina... I can't think of her name.
I don't know her name.
Regina
George from Mean Girls. Like, they're trying to make her out to that, but she's not. She's just...
I don't think that's what they were trying to do because Mean Girls didn't exist yet.
No, I understand that, but, like...
They were trying to remake Mean Girls.
Yeah, they were trying to make Mean Girls back in 1986. But what they're trying to do is make her out to be this totally mean girl, but she's not. She's just somebody that's just obsessed with her own self and her friends, and she doesn't pay attention to the poor. That's all it is. It sucks. It's not as bad as Regina George. But, you know, like, you know, whatever.
No, I get, again, I don't hold her. I don't hold that character to today's standards.
No.
It was just like, we totally did not expect it. No. We're just watching the movie.
It was out of nowhere.
And the way she's, it's just so like
it was a heart.
What?
So
I am always gonna laugh at the absurd.
Yeah,
and,
no, it was.
And it is okay for people to not like that about me.
We were that way when we were kids and this movie came out. We said that all the time.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. To this day, that word meant to me back then, it meant douchebag.
Yeah.
That's how we used homosexuality.
Well,
it meant like you didn't call gay people that word. That would be fucking awful.
What matters is we called
assholes and douchebags that word.
South Park did this.
They already covered that.
Yeah,
yep.
They covered this perfectly.
Actually couldn't have said it better.
Exactly. No,
it's perfect.
But so I mean, I like this. The date was the most awkward thing I think I've ever seen.
It was kind of a bad date.
In a John Hughes movie.
Yeah, because he took her to do like to his world,
right?
And she wasn't into it.
No.
Yeah. Well, in this scene, I also have that the band playing at the club this time is called the Talkback.
It's not the same band. I thought it was the same band.
Rave Ups.
Yeah, it was the same band.
The Talkback, and they're playing Rudy. That's Rudy. I have my research.
Rudy.
Because in the first one, the Rave Ups have that bass player.
The singing. I thought it was the same. It's the same band, right?
I don't Trout? Think so.
I think so, yeah.
I think we're gonna have to rewatch this.
The next morning, we see BMX badass Duckie still stalking Andy as she leaves for Iona's house to gossip about her date and going to prom. Iona shows Andy her prom dress as she remembers her youth. Duckie creepily waits outside. Iona informs Andy that she has to get ready for a date with a new guy who owns a pet store. Before Andy leaves, Iona offers advice about being nice to Duckie because he's heartbroken. Meanwhile, we see Blaine is hanging out with his best friend, Steph. Steph tells Blaine that everybody is talking about Blaine hanging out with trash, reminding him that not only his peers were accepting of Andy, weren't accepting of Andy, but Blaine's parents would also not approve of the couple. Steph offers a final ultimatum, their friendship or Andy. Blaine must choose. The next scene, we see Blaine and Andy on another date at some horse stables. Their conversation quickly turns to forces that are working against them. They begin to kiss, but seem to share a sadness as if they know it can't last forever. Meanwhile, we see Duckie listening to Morrissey in his room, drowning in depression. The next day, Andy shops for a prom dress while avoiding a run-in with the bully bitches from school. We also start to see signs that Blaine is having second thoughts. He's avoiding Andy's phone calls. Jack comes home with a pink prom dress he bought to surprise his daughter. Andy knows he had been lying about having a job, and she's upset that he is spending money they don't have. Jack and Andy begin to argue about Jack's excuses. With all the things that Andy is going through, she needs Jack to get his shit together. Andy's mom isn't coming back. The two share a tearful embrace, and Jack leaves Andy's room, and Andy looks at a picture of her mother and cries herself to sleep.
Did they bone in the horse stables? I'm trying to figure it out.
I actually didn't consider it, maybe, but I don't know.
They're acting like this is they're the new Romeo and Juliet.
Well, it's because he just got an ultimatum from his friends being like, yo, man, I know you're like hanging out with that girl, but just so you know, your parents and all of us and your friends, everyone you know, is not cool with it. So, you know, like something's going to have to give. And you can almost see that, like that sort of push and pull is happening when he's on this next date. He's like there and he feels like, yeah, I like her and he's kissing her, but he knows that this isn't going to work.
Right. And I mean, like, I get.
She's kind of having those similar feelings. But, like, she doesn't believe that this rich guy likes her.
From this point on, they're acting like they are like Romeo and Juliet. Like this, they are the couple of the century. If they just kissed and hugged in there, like, you're not missing out on anything. But like, I get it. Like if this was her losing her virginity or something like that in that moment, that's kind of like what it's lending itself to, but you don't see anything like that. So it's confusing as shit to me why there's so much weight on this couple. It's not explained, and it's frustrating to me.
No, I never put that. I think the weight was that there's forces working against them.
Okay. I mean, like, so that's why I posed the question, because it's just confusing as shit to me. This whole thing.
What is more confusing than Duckie riding that fucking wheelie for so long? Can you critique what you see?
That was not John Cryer.
It definitely wasn't.
No, it wasn't John Cryer. Come on.
Did you know who the fucking stunt double is?
Yeah.
Was it Rodney Mullen?
No. Oh. Rodney Mullen's a skater, dude.
I know.
Yeah, no, it's not a rollerblader.
Yeah, so what he's doing in this scene, almost if you're familiar with that era of BMX.
Nobody is.
The one-handed wheelie.
Yeah.
Gives him away who the stunt rider is. The way he does it.
Is it Crew Jones?
It's Pat Romano.
Oh.
Pat Romano, if you've ever seen Rad, is riding one-handed wheelies on top of the
That's
trailer.
Why I dropped the Crew Jones. I have seen it.
Well, it's not Crew Jones, though.
Oh.
During the parade.
He's a character in Rad.
During the parade in Cochrane, in Rad, when they there's like the little Shriner guys in the clown cars and shit, and there's a fucking...
Sure.
I think it's a GT, Team GT, like 18-wheeler. There's a dude on top of that riding wheelies one-handed on top of the fucking trailer.
So that's like his shit.
That's Pat Romano. He's, yeah, the one-handed wheelies. And he's also, as he's riding down the alley, he starts to do a surfer, which is you stand one foot on the seat, one foot on the bars, and you're like standing straight up on the bike, like up on top of it.
So did he have a mountain bike?
No, he didn't have a mountain bike.
I don't know, dude. Like,
did you not look at the bike he was riding? It was a BMX
bike.
No,
like, I love that you love bike BMXing. and I want you to teach my son how to do that. It's awesome.
When you said one-handed Willie, I just was thinking of one-eyed Willie.
Yeah, me too.
One-handed Willie. One-handed Willie. Yeah, he was the most famous BMXer of our time.
Crew Jones?
Yeah, we should go down some water slides through a fucking cave and find his treasure.
Anyway, that you might remember earlier in the recording of this podcast, this episode, several hours ago.
Yes.
That I mentioned, Duckie's got some cool moments. That's one of them.
That's it.
The one.
No, there's another one. Duckie. There's
it
another
wasn't
one.
Even John Cryer.
It doesn't matter. It's his character, man.
And think about his cool ass one hand wheelie was all to service his stalking.
Listen, there is another scene where he's pretty cool. A couple other things about this whole scene.
No, he doesn't die in this movie.
we get to see another moment of Jack being heartbroken.
Who?
Jack?
Henry Dean Stanton. That's right.
Harry Dean Stanton.
It sure is.
As you can see, it sucks as it cuts. It certainly does suck.
Go on. Sorry.
Anyway.
Jack is doing what?
Well, you know, that scene with Jack and Andy where he's, you know, they're crying. And
yeah.
He is so heartbroken and cannot let go.
Right. No, I totally get it. And it's only been 3 years. That's
you feel for the guy. But you know what I mean?
He's like a drug addict liar, though.
Yeah.
That's the thing that kind of bums me out where he gives those like, he's like completely full of shit.
Yeah.
It's not like he's unintentionally lying because like he's down on his luck. He's like, no, it's totally. I got it worked out when he doesn't. He reminds me of that. Like that sort of like almost alcoholic drug addict. But this is all just depression based on a broken heart. But his way of like constantly letting Andy down, not getting a job, all of that. Just comes from more of like a loser than a depression.
Yeah, I mean, you know,
but it's weird.
Heartbreak is one thing, but yeah, when you've got a kid to take care of, you need to like step it up.
Yep.
You got to pull your britches up
by your bootstraps. I've been there. I've been in like the depths of depression, and I have a kid, and it is tough. I've never allowed myself to do that to where Henry Dan Stanton is, but.
Fuck you. Henry Dan Stanton. That might be the best one yet.
When you're talking about his daughter, like Molly Ringwald is what, 17?
She's 18. 18. They say her age.
So she's 18. So she was 15, less than a fifth of her life that like she has been gone. Like
it is so weird.
It is
like, again, it's formative. It's yeah, formative.
I mean, she's acting
like, who gives a fuck about mom? Come on, let's get this shit together. Get a job.
She's trying to.
I'm trying to get laid and find out where I'm going to college.
She's trying to move on and be a teenager. He can't allow it.
It's like, oh, my little girl's growing up. You know who else is growing up? Your mom.
Your mom.
I miss your mom.
A few other things that are a little lighthearted.
Okay.
About this scene.
Okay.
We hear Cherish by the Association. Great song. This soundtrack is awesome.
It is a pretty good soundtrack.
Duckie being a fucking sad boy with his fucking Morrissey playing.
Dude, I mean,
do you know what Smith songs he's listening to?
No, I don't.
The name of the song, I just thought there's comedy in this.
Because do you know about their lyrics and shit?
Yeah, yeah. I know all about it. I still like Girlfriend in a Coma. It's on playlist. I think
there's a couple
Girlfriend
songs.
In a Coma, I know.
How Soon Is Now is a great song.
I do not pay attention to the lyrics. So
the name of this song is
over my head.
The thing about the Smiths and their song titles and their lyrics, they are caricatures of themselves.
Okay.
The name of this song is Please, Please, Please Let Me Get What I Want. Just think that's funny.
It is.
You should like
Morrissey.
Homework for the next week is like go and just go Google some like Morrissey lyrics.
No, the lyrics are actually super blunt and honest.
No, I understand Morrissey. I am sad because the Smiths is all about just like being like emo before it was emo.
That's why I said he's being a sad boy.
He's emo.
And perfect soundtrack for being a sad boy.
Right.
I think that's all I had for that episode or for that scene.
Or about how ugly that fucking dress was that he brought home. Maybe it was cool in 86. I don't know. But I remember seeing that being like, Jesus.
Yeah. No, I think that's why she was like, thanks for this. Like he knew that it was a piece of shit.
He was like, you'll be able to make something out of it.
Exactly. Yeah. Like, yeah, you're going to be able to do something with that.
I'd get you shoes, but I didn't know what size you were.
Yeah.
Okay.
You weren't going to get her shoes, you liar.
No, you weren't. No, I mean, I don't have anything else on this, so let's move on.
The next morning at school, Andy waits angrily for Blaine outside of his class. She demands to know why Blaine is avoiding her. Blaine denies avoiding her, but he seems distant. She then asks him about prom. Blaine attempts to put off the conversation until later, but she persists. She can sense what the answer is at this point, but she wants to hear him say it. We see that people are eavesdropping at this point, including Duckie and Steph from afar. Blaine lets out a breath and says he had already asked someone else a month ago and forgot. Andy begins screaming at Blaine, calling him a liar, pushing him against the wall, and ordering him to admit the truth, that he was embarrassed to be seen with her. Blaine's eyes welled up with tears. He knew she was right. He attempted another lie, telling her it was too complicated, but she had nothing to do with it. Andy storms off completely crushed. Steph then approaches Blaine in the stairwell, unaware that Duckie can see and hear them from where he was standing. Steph tells Blaine that Andy isn't worth it and that she will always be a loser. An upset Blaine turns his back on Steph and walks away. But Duckie wasn't about to let Steph get away with the things he was saying about Andy. Duckie attacks Steph from behind. The two begin to scuffle in the hallway before the fight is broken up by a teacher. Later that evening, we see Andy arrive at Iona's house for some advice. Iona is getting ready for another date. Andy begins to cry about her breakup with Blaine and asks Iona for her old prom dress. Now at home with two pink prom dresses in hand, a motivated Andy begins designing, cutting, and sewing the two dresses into one funky, homemade-looking dress with her own personal style. Andy didn't need a date. She needed to show everyone that she wasn't broken. She would go stag to the prom.
Can we just... It would take a couple of days to make that dress.
Just
no.
I mean, it's movie magic. I get it. But it's just like...
No, she's into that shit. She would have made it happen in a night.
Well, let's be honest. No, I bet she could make it happen. She did. And this wasn't just that night. Because did you notice in the scene she borrowed that dress from Iona?
Yeah.
She goes home, starts making it. And then at some point it shows Iona is doing her hair.
Well, that's right. That's
so this
right.
is like, yeah, yeah, so this is some sort of days. Like kind of a montage right. thing.
So, okay, yeah. So I guess it is a montage. But can we, Iona with that beehive do looked amazing.
Yeah, like she was like looking her age because she was going out with like a guy with a real job.
So like I had
B-52s vibes a little bit.
Yeah. So yeah. I like
that scene where she's talking about being in love and like comforting Andy. Iona's fucking awesome. Annie Potts like just killed that role. She was great. Also good on Duckie to go after Steph.
Dude, totally.
He did
this
was
the one redeeming point of Duckie in this whole thing. And he got a couple hits on them too.
That's that's the other part I was talking about where he's like, he's cool there.
So like this.
Yeah. I mean, he redeems himself a little bit.
I mean, shout out to the 80s and 90s back whenever you could get into a fight in school and it wasn't like, you know, call the police type of shit like we have now.
Or the guy that you kick his ass isn't going to show up tomorrow with a gun and shoot everybody.
Yeah. So like, It was like, hey, we're let them like have a little bit of fisticuffs and then call it done, move on. And they didn't like they just let Duckie run off like a little bitch. But like, I mean, they just let him run off. It was fine. And
the way he ran off was like super like obnoxious too.
Yeah. Yeah. Like, he like ripped down a banner.
Yeah.
He like jumped up and ripped down a banner that was hanging in the high school.
Like, yeah, you showed them, dude. Like, come on.
To me, this part is when she reveals the dress she made. To her father?
Yeah.
This is the ugliest she's ever looked to me.
So this is what you were saying earlier?
I think the big reveal, yeah. She looked like dog shit there. The whole movie, she looked better than the prom reveal.
I think it's just the dress.
It's, yeah.
Of the 80s.
It's that dress and the way it fits and everything. Yeah. It's just like so unflattering. I think she looks terrible in that part.
And again, it was the 80s, you know, cocaine.
You know, it was cocaine, fucking leaded gasoline.
Cocaine existed, so this girl looks like shit.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, dude, they had lead in the gas. This chick was,
you know,
of course, going to look terrible.
You know, yeah. that's anything else on this?
Not on that scene.
All right, we're getting to the final scene right here. At the prom, we see Blaine sitting alone
looking sad, and fuckboy Steph trying to rush his date to the hotel for sex. Then a nervous and alone Andy shows up, but before she can enter, she sees an apologetic Duckie waiting for her. He didn't want her to go alone. She is excited to see him and the two make up. They enter the prom together. Their friendship has never been stronger. Blaine sees Andy enter with Duckie and begins to approach them. Steph stops Blaine to make fun of Andy and Duckie. Blaine is sick of Steph's bullshit and tells him to eat a bag of dicks and continues his march towards Andy. He extends a peace offering to Duckie in the form of a handshake and begins his honest apology to Andy. He confesses that he had always believed in her. He just didn't believe in it himself, and he loves her. He walks away before she can answer. Duckie encourages Andy that he seems like a great guy and that she should go after him. Andy gives Duckie a big hug and runs for the parking lot to catch Blaine. Duckie then locks eyes with an attractive woman and the two begin to dance with one another. Andy makes it to Blaine just before he gets to his car, and the two share a passionate kiss as the credits begin to roll.
Another terrible kiss.
Motherfucker. Yeah. Okay.
Another terrible kiss between these two.
Can I just say?
Yeah, it is a weird one.
In the book where
it's
Andy
not
and
the
Duckie,
book. It's that they shot the movie this way and then reshot it.
Yeah. Well, and they shot the movie this way because the movie was written this way. And they also made a book. But then they were like, oh, this is a pile of shit. The test audiences hate it. So they redid the ending, but did not redo.
And
the
that book. Was Andy and Duckie ending up together.
Yes. Duckie.
Yeah.
Was
the original ending was Duckie
her.
And Andy.
And that's now.
And remember, also, that was the intended ending. They even shot it that way.
Right.
Even though we saw all these scenes of these two not being compatible at fucking all, you know how much you would have really had to convince me as the viewer that she all of a sudden was like, you know what? I do like Duckie.
Yeah. But you know
because
what?
Because us, the viewer could not.
That wasn't the reason the critics and the test audience didn't like it though.
Can we, I'm sorry. Andy and Blaine, they didn't deserve to be together. Blaine didn't deserve Andy. I'm sorry.
No, they were going to break up.
They have very little interaction, and all of a sudden they're in love.
They liked each other from afar, from different socioeconomics, and there was a lot working against them. And that's it. You know, that's like the gist of it.
He completely ghosts her right before the prom and then says, fuck you, I already invited somebody else. And
that's
then all of a sudden
the whole point.
It's not earned. That's it. He doesn't deserve Molly Ringwald.
Bullshit. Like,
he does.
His character says right there at the end, listen, man, it wasn't that I didn't believe in you. It's that I didn't believe in me. He basically admitted that all of this is because I am too insecure. Like, and that's why she was into it. He didn't come and be like, sorry, I didn't tell the truth. He's basically saying like, I'm the asshole because everything that happened had nothing to do with you. You were perfect the way you are. I just am a dick because my friends got to me. They made
so,
me think
so
something.
That completely makes up for all of the shit that he just laid onto her in the past,
it
let's
can,
say, a week.
Yeah, honesty
no,
can go a long way,
it
for sure.
It doesn't. But like, I got
you
to
would
this
know
ending.
That,
I was
though.
Pissed at this ending. I'm like, fuck off.
Honesty like, can go a long way, sure.
He doesn't deserve the great Molly Ringwald. This is an unearned ending. It pissed me off. I was...
So you wanted to see her at Duckie?
No, she deserves... She's going to college
he
here
is raging
in a month.
Right now.
I am raging. She is going to college here in a month or so. She's going to find some dude that's going to actually treat her great.
I agree.
For like a year or two.
She will.
She
but is, in the meantime, she should not bang who she wants to bang.
Let her do that, but she's
she
not
wants to bang Blaine.
Don't like it's setting up this whole.
She wants to bang Blaine.
She then let her bang Blaine.
Let her bang Blaine.
Yeah.
I want her to bang Blaine.
But it's setting up this whole bullshit idea that kids continue to follow of, hey, you're going to find the love of your life in high school. And then like you, whenever you're in high school and
you just
don't
Fox
find that
news
person,
the hell out of that. You're like, kids continue to do it to this day.
But
they're
no,
out there making
no,
your kids fall in love.
No, like it's this entire bullshit idea that like you're gonna find the love of your life in high school. And it's just like
I don't think they sold that though. They just after that prom, she picked him and they kissed. There was no happily ever after.
No, she's in love. Like that's like been the entire thing.
Yeah, me and my high school girlfriend thought we were in love.
I know, but like
we're both married to other people. It's fine. They're just that's where it was in high school. I'm kind of going back to that too because I was laying all this on
Duckie, but again, if you, it does make sense that if these characters are 16 to 18 years old in this range, that of course they're going to be going around like doing dumb shit and like making mistakes and fucking up.
We need to touch on a few things in that scene before we move on to
totally.
The alternate ending.
Totally.
We skipped a lot.
I'm sorry. It pissed me off.
Yeah,
if you did not pick up on it, it pissed me off.
We should have kept that like after we talked about the scene. But did you guys notice the two guys with the synthesizers that were playing the prom?
Were they guitars? It was like a Daft Punk
No,
setup.
It was synthesizers, like decked synthesizers. Steph never stopped smoking cigarettes ever. This is the anti-smoking podcast. Duckie, guys.
Yeah.
When he appears at the top of the steps, when she gets there, he looks fucking rad.
He looks rad as fuck. He does have a decent tux scene, right? Like that's it. He looks dope, and like that's exactly what Molly Ringwald needed at that point.
His reaction to Blaine wanting to shake hands, like what was that?
No. You could tell he was like at that point, he's like, fuck you.
Yeah. He like does like a weird, like, I can't even describe it. He like visibly, physically reacts to it in a like really awkward way.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And then we're introduced to Duckette, Christy Swanson.
Christy Swanson is the one who waged him. At first, when I watched it, I thought it was just one of the bully chicks.
See,
I've been bullying him the whole movie, and I'm like, oh, he's going to end up with it. What the fuck? And then I had learned that was Christy Swanson's like first role in a movie.
Like I was so rage watching at this point, like I didn't even pick up on that. I love Christy Swanson, like Buffy the Vampire Slayer, the movie.
That's the only shit I ever watched, and that shit is dope. Yeah. I like the movie.
Okay, so back to the original ending. You know, the way that we see the movie is the reshot ending. It's not the original ending,
right?
The original ending had Andy and Duckie getting together.
And they shot that shit.
But that was what they showed the test audiences. But it was poorly received because the critics in the crowd said it was classist to think that rich and poor people couldn't end up together. And also the story was like a Cinderella story. And for Andy to end up with Duckie would have made the whole premise of the movie irrelevant.
Yeah, I mean, and they were supposed to dance to David Bowie Heroes. That's what they shot. They were going to go in and dance to David Bowie, and then the credits were going to roll.
Like, so I completely disagree with everything that they just said, because it's not saying that they can't be compatible. It's saying that these two people can't be compatible. Blaine is being a dick. That's why they're not compatible. But I get, God damn it. Like, I hate to concede to that point. God damn it.
Yeah, but you got to, I had to on the earlier stuff. Like, I am annoyed by Duckie's character, but he's a young guy.
To the point. I get it, what the fucking test audience are saying. God damn it.
Yeah, that's what it was, is they had actually shot it and the test audiences hated it. But Hollywood was like, yeah, but the rich guy shouldn't win.
Exactly.
They didn't want Blaine to win, but the test audience are like, yeah, but that guy's a twerpy douchebag that like is a panty dryer. So that he can't get the girl.
They actually said that.
Yeah.
Panty dryer. They said panty dryer.
Yeah. As long as you keep the lint trap.
They had to like write that in and then bubble it. Like, all right. So we all agree that Andy should not have ended up with Blaine. I get it. That's cool. I like it.
So you want Andy to end up with Duckie?
No, I want her to go find some dude at fucking,
I think where, the movie,
like NYU, I don't, or wherever she's going.
The way the movie should have ended, I don't condone, but I think it should have been.
What are you saying? How it should have owned?
I am trying to. I think that Steph should have Cosby'd her, and it should have been a tragic ending, and it should have been very sad.
So it should have just taken like a 90-degree turn.
Yeah.
Okay.
What do you mean Cosby'd her?
What do you mean?
Roofied, and like
if someone Cosby'd somebody, you couldn't figure out what that meant.
No,
just based off our references.
No, so what?
Do you know who Bill Cosby is?
And I know that he was like in trouble for some shit with women, but I don't know.
No. What he did was he forced a sweater on them and made them walk around being like, "I'm the dude, Jello pudding pops."
I was gonna say if he didn't say fucking pudding pops, then the trope wasn't gonna. No, I don't think that she should have gotten raped at the end. I was just being
okay. On to the movie.
So,
I did have a couple of notes.
Okay, what are your notes?
Well, I had the note about Dweezil Zappa. Did you know who the stunt coordinator in this movie is?
Steve Perry.
Nope. Dick Hancock. Just thought it was... just watching the credits. Just watching the credits and the stunt coordinator caught my eye. Yeah, I wrote the notes about the original ending, but here's the best part. We did not get into this yet.
The Brad Pack?
No. Did anyone notice that Blaine, in that last ending at the prom, how his hair looked a little darker, a little flatter.
It was a reshoot.
A little weird. Yeah, it was a reshoot. So yeah. Why does his hair look so fucking weird?
He had lost weight, too.
Yeah.
Yep.
Because he was getting weak into Bernie shit.
Nope. He was doing a play in New York City. He had already moved on, and he had shaved his head for this play. So that is a fucking wig in the last scene. And if you were to talk to Andrew McCarthy about it, to this day, he's like, that fucking wig, man. Oh, my God.
He hated it?
Yeah, and I didn't notice it either. I mean, I kind of did at one point. I'm like, why does his hair look so bad? That must be the way he styled it for prom. Then now that you know it, if you were to go back and see it, it looks like a fucking wig. It's bad.
Can we just,
it looks so bad.
Can we just talk for a moment about the whole Andy? No, I'm sorry. Andrew McCarthy. Blaine and Steph confrontation there. You couldn't buy her. You couldn't buy her, and that's what made you so mad. Like,
that was a weird, like, forced thing. Like,
yeah.
Which is kind of what it was, is because we saw in the beginning of the movie that Steph was like, hey, hitting on her. And she's like, yeah, fuck off. You know, I don't want you. You always try this bullshit. And so we know that as the viewer that this chick turns him down. So, you know, he always acts like. But the thing is, she never calls him out.
Right.
She's never like, you tried to fuck me the other day, you dipshit. She's always just.
So it's forced with Andrew McCarthy doing it. Like, and the whole, like him, that realization that comes out of fucking nowhere. Like, it was forced, like, obviously that's part of the reshoot. It was a force, like, hey, we have to wrap this shit up. Like, it could have been done with a nod or something, like, so much quicker, just being like a.
There could have been a more creative way, but I'm wondering if they just had rushed it in the reshoot or something.
No, I mean, like, was this part? I don't know.
I think the whole problem was the reshot because, she was going to go and end up with Duckie.
I think it, like, ending with her getting with Duckie would have been a more solid ending. I get
gross.
We're still on that?
You're still on
no.
that.
No.
God damn it. All right.
Bye. Did you know the studio wanted Jennifer Beal for Andy?
Who's Jennifer Beal?
She played in Flashdance. Okay. That's about all I can give you. She was kind of bigger back then, but I don't really know.
Wait, is she the maniac?
But Anthony Michael Hall also was supposed to be Duckie. He actually got the part and turned it down. He would have been better straight up just because anyone would have. Molly Ringwald, she wanted Robert Downey Jr. because she thought he was hot and she had she thought they would have chemistry. So she wanted Robert Downey Jr. He also turned it down.
For who, Duckie?
For Duckie. Because remember, she was supposed to end up with the guy. So
well, because
she said herself that she had no chemistry with John Cryer and she wasn't attracted to him. And so she was one of the people being like, I don't want to end up, my character should not end up with Duckie.
Well, so
she was pushing for it not to happen the whole time.
Do you guys remember the movie?
She even said, this isn't going to work.
Do you guys remember the movie?
Oh, of course I do.
Do you remember Robert Downey Jr.'s role in that?
Yes.
He would have been an amazing Duckie.
Well, she saw him in something before that. God, it's not hitting me right now. I probably know it if I heard it, but she saw him something before that, thought he was like really attractive and wanted the character played a little more cool like that.
I think Robert Downey Jr. in that role would have like fucking killed it. And like, it would not have made me pissed off so much.
And I'll have one other note that the Otis Redding, Try a Little Tenderness. Originally they were going to get State of Shock by Mick Jagger and Michael Jackson.
Oh, so much better call.
And
on the Otis Redding.
They couldn't get the rights to that. And then their second choice was Start Me Up by the Rolling Stones.
Oh, God.
I don't think that would have worked there at all for the lip syncing and shit.
What was it going to be, your third, like Gary Glitter? Like, fuck.
Yeah. Stuff you hear at kickoffs.
Yeah.
No, I'm glad with the way that turned out. The Otis Redding was
No, the Otis Redding was perfect.
Did you guys know this was filmed at the same high school?
Jesus Christ.
Same high school as Breakfast Club and Home Alone and all that?
No.
What house was the big party at? Was it?
Why'd you say Jesus Christ?
I know that you're gonna give us some.
No, it's the same high school as Grease, which I fucking hate Grease.
Okay. No. Like, I like, you're just always like, hey, did you know this house was like.
Yeah, those are interesting tidbits.
No, I know. But like, I look for that shit and I can't find it. I don't know where you find it.
The candy machine thing about the tampon machine. You know, when he says that was ad-libbed by John Cryer.
Yeah, because it happened to him in real life because he'd been bullied in real life.
Really?
I think so.
He deserves it.
Mm-hmm. Also, this is actually really interesting. The genesis of this movie emerged when Molly Ringwald asked John Hughes to write a movie based on the psychedelic first song, Pretty in Pink, which was her favorite song at the time. Yeah, so she planted really this. She planted this kind of in his brain, and then
during 16 Candles,
wasn't even like the only person considered for Andy.
Really?
Mm-hmm.
Speaking of other people,
John Hughes did lobby for her, but the studio was trying to get someone else.
That's Christy Swanson's film debut, actually, by the way.
Yes, it was. I had heard that. And then she did Buffy the Vampire Slayer. Do you remember that other movie she did? Fucking with Charlie Sheen.
The Chase.
The Chase. Had Anthony Kiedis and Flea and shit.
Yeah.
And Henry Rollins. Dude,
that
Rollins.
Was so good.
Henry
like, Rollins. And like, was dope. And like, I think like Flea's best roles are in trucks.
Of course.
Because that was Back to the Future 3.
And the Chase. Fly. Nice set of wheels. Hey, Needles. Jason, you were right earlier. The other band is the Talkback.
Yeah, I know I'm right. I honestly thought they were fake. I thought they were real bands playing fake bands. So I was like.
No, they're real bands.
I thought like. You know, one of them was going to be some band we'd heard of. I hadn't heard of either.
Wow, Justine Bateman reportedly returned down the role of Andy, too.
Justine Bateman, dude.
Yeah. Okay, guys. Let's rate this sucker.
All right, I'll start. I'm going to rate this. You guys might think I'm going to rate it.
Wait. The ratings, just like, because we have new kids. We might have new kids here. Like, we have Own It.
Yeah, like
watch it,
buy it, watch it, or don't watch it. And you might think I'm going to say don't watch it. I have a hard time committing to don't watch. But this is definitely not a buy. So I'll say watch it once. Just to, you know, form some opinions on Duckie.
So you see it on TNT and you watch it. Is that what you're saying?
I mean, again, I think most movies are redeemable. I think that this has a place. I do think that people will like it. I found myself being distractedly annoyed by Duckie's character. But hey, at least watch it and you can see what I'm talking about. Maybe you'll agree, maybe not. But I'm going to say watch.
All right, Shroudberg.
Not buy this.
All right, Shroudberg.
I would watch this again several times in the future. I might even buy it.
Mm.
Ooh, God.
Ouch. Just to have it. There are some redeeming things about it. I think that Annie Potts kills it in this movie.
Yeah, I agree with that.
I enjoy the very brief BMX scene. I definitely would watch it again, but I might commit to buying a used Blu-ray from like vintage stock.
Okay, so you got to go one or the other, bro.
If I saw this at Vintage Stock for $5, I'd buy it. Okay. I've never looked for it there. I'm sure it's there.
Yeah, it is. Don't watch and watch. So I mean, I kind of get teetering between.
So, but you have to choose one.
I chose watch.
Okay, watch.
It's tough.
I'm like pissed on this shit. Don't watch it. Go watch the better version of it as in 16 Candles with Long Duck Dong. And
that's not a version of it though. It's not the same movie.
It's not the same movie, but it kind of is. Like girl likes guy, they get together.
You just spoiled 16 Candles for me?
Don't buy this one. Don't watch it. It's fine. Like you can just read the Wikipedia synopsis of it and be good. Like you're not missing anything on it other than Annie Potts.
Hollywood's calling. They need us to recast this bullshit.
Oh, they're going to do a remake?
Oh, shit.
That's all they do.
Oh, no.
Okay. All they do is remakes, and they need us to recast it. Guys, I can start this one first, and we normally do one character at a time, and we still can, but I personally, I had an issue because I needed to find a bunch of 18-year-olds. I didn't know a lot, and when I'm looking them up, I don't. Know most of them.
It's okay.
I don't want to judge them on looks.
Like, we're still going to do one at a time. We're still going to do one at a time.
You guys can. So I'm not. Because here's what I'm saying is we're literally, I just take Stranger Things and cut
God
and paste.
God damn it.
Just cut and paste Stranger Things.
All right.
That cast is fine. That cast is fine. You can make whoever play whoever. I don't give a fuck.
even you can make Winona Ryder Annie Potts, and then Seven is Molly Ringwald, and then the other boys can do whatever.
Dude, I also went with Millie Bobby Brown for Andy.
There, all right, see? I bet he picked that wolf. I picked he picked that wolf kid. What's his name? I bet he's in your shit.
He's not in there. He's not on
Wolf
mine.
Finhard or Finn yes, Wolfhard Finhard. Or whatever.
Hey, hold on. With Andy Potts.
Finn Wolfhard.
Hold on. Because
Wolf Finhard? Wolf Finhard.
Wolf. It's one of those.
Finn Wolfhard. my reason, though, for casting Millie Bobby Brown as Andy, because Molly Ringwald kind of had that artsy.
Yeah, yeah. I could see it.
And Millie Bobby Brown is kind of an artsy type, too. So I just, you know, I thought about it a little bit.
Yeah.
I didn't just throw a name at it.
I did, too. I mean, as far as when I look up young actors, I saw a couple of those kids. And I'm like, oh, they're good. Because I don't know a lot of them.
You dumb motherfuckers. And I just,
dude, it's funny.
Yeah, you feel the same way?
No. She's on the brain because I like clicked a, she did it. She did Jimmy Fallon not too long ago or something.
Oh, okay. She rapped?
And I fucking, anyway, I saw this interview of her and Jimmy Fallon. And so like it was in my feed of like, you might like this or whatever. So I clicked on it. And now every day when I go to that feed, there's Millie Bobby Brown interviews and like her like talking on the fucking red carpet and shit. And I'm like,
yeah,
Instagram is
Instagram's a bitch.
It thinks I want to watch Millie Bobby Brown
the whole day. Dumb motherfuckers are missing the highlight spot of the Stranger Things cast. Fucking Sadie Sink.
Demogorgon. Wow. So hold on. Sorry.
Sadie Sink, the redhead. In there.
I remember her.
Have you seen her in like, she's been in a couple of other things and she fucking kills it. She has the range to take the place of Molly Ringwald in this spot.
I can see it.
She also is a natural redhead as well. So
that's like, why I said take the cast of Stranger Things, just throw them the fuck in there, mix them up any way you want.
Well, it's because you're lazy.
No, well, there's a bit of that, but there's also, I can't really commit to like who's, I don't know these actors well enough to like, it's tough to cast teenagers.
Teenagers. But
it's really tough.
I didn't anticipate it. So the next one. So for Duckie is Jack Dylan Grazer. Do you guys know who that is?
Sounds familiar, but no.
Eddie from It. The one that the fucking loud, obnoxious one. Shrout, who did you have?
I had Griffin Gluck.
Would I know him?
You would know him from Just Go With It.
I don't know that.
He's Jennifer Aniston's son in Just Go With It.
Oh, the Adam Sandler one.
When he's like, I don't know. He's like trying to bribe him and he goes, go on. I'm listening.
Yeah. Or whatever.
That kid's like 18 or something now. So he's like a skinny kind of weird dude.
Yeah. All right. But who'd you have for Blaine though? Since Jason's out of this one.
I actually had Chandler Riggs, Carl Grimes himself from The Walking Dead.
Coral?
Or Coral.
Yeah, Coral. Yeah.
So Coral is going to be Blaine.
Coral is going to be Blaine.
Okay. Nah, dude. Yeah. Tanner Buchanan.
That's who I cast as Steph.
Oh. Who the fuck is Tanner Buchanan?
He played Johnny Lawrence's son on Cobra Kai.
Yeah. Yeah. Have you watched the new Cobra
Kai? Which Cobra Kai is fucking awesome.
Yeah, I did watch that. I do like that. I forgot about those two.
So,
teenagers.
You know Robbie?
Yeah, yeah.
Robbie, that's Tanner Buchanan.
His son.
Okay. No, dude, no, like him and Blaine,
he totally has a John Brandis like that vibe.
Fucking jaw. Like it reminds me and of like, like, who wouldn't fall in love with that face? Especially, Sadie Sink would definitely do that.
So would Kevin Spacey. But
so for Steph, who doesn't fall in love with Tanner Buchanan, it's Caleb McLaughlin, the black kid from Stranger Things.
Okay. Again, it seems like we're seeing a lot.
If
of Stranger
I had watched
Things,
more
guys.
Of Stranger Things, I might
dude,
have
you
gone.
See, you got
You didn't
you
watch much of that?
That, shit. That first season, I went. I think I did. I watch. Yeah, I watched the whole thing. It was. I had to start it twice because I was so bored.
I had to do that. I don't think
it's like the best thing ever, but it does have nostalgia.
I like the
bombs.
Vibe.
It's fun.
The vibe was totally like Goonies meets Monster
That's
Squad.
That's what they were going after.
But like, it still was like really hard to watch. It was kind of boring.
I just want to say this is the second time that you brought
those kids
Monster
are good
Squad,
actors,
and
though.
When I wear the Stephen King's rules. Shirt, you didn't call it out. I just want to say that.
Yeah, because I don't know Monster Squad that well. Yeah,
Monster Squad fucking rules.
Wolfman has nards.
So
what about Henry Dan Steeden?
Jack?
Yeah.
Who did you have?
I had Chris Pratt. Not Andy Samberg.
I went Thomas Ian Nicholas.
Who's that guy?
Rookie of the Year. Kevin from American Pie.
Yes. Oh, the main kid.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. He's the dad? You made him the dad?
Yeah, that's Millie Bobby Brown's dad.
Okay.
Are you fucking serious?
Not in real life. Say it in the movie.
Oh, I thought you said that was like really his dad. Her dad.
No, her real dad is Bobby Brown.
Yeah, from like that's what I thought.
Yeah,
from, like,
Whitney Houston.
Yeah, Whitney Houston's. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, Millie is short for Whitney.
All right. So I have a double casting. I pulled a Jason for Annie Potts for Iona. Who did you have?
I'm not a fan of this double casting thing that you guys do.
No. So I'll just do
from
my
here
main
on
one.
Out, you got to pick one.
I always did pick one.
I'll do my one.
To show the backup.
That's it.
It's fun.
All right, you go Shrout for your number one.
Miley Cyrus.
Oof.
Fuck yeah.
That's a good one.
See?
That's it.
She can do it.
No,
she can kill it.
However, I think because of her turn at the end, Anna Kendrick would fucking kill it even more.
She's pretty much good in anything. I think she could kill it.
She would kill it. Anna Kendrick, because you remember her in Scott Pilgrim?
It's cool.
But so like I think I won the casting.
Yeah, I didn't feel good about this one.
I ruled this.
You think
one.
You won it?
I threw half of the
Stranger Things cast at
no,
it.
No, I didn't. Two.
Yeah, you pretty much just copied my cast.
No, I didn't. I had two. Two.
I don't think you. I think your cast was kind of lazy.
No. Yeah. I rule.
I mean, you didn't have Halle Berry fucking
Clint Howard. I don't want to cast kids anymore, at least for a while.
Yeah, neither did I. It was bad.
All right, now it is time for us to pull in a new fucking movie.
I'm excited to get something else going.
All right,
going.
So I got a new...
I'm done with Pretty in Pink. Let's see what we got.
I was bored the other day at work, and I built us a new wheel, so it's not going to go as
long. Look how nice that looks.
Oh, it's so nice. All right, you guys ready?
We need a break from the 80s.
Let's get a break from the 80s.
Seriously,
everything's been in the same vein.
Here it goes. It's spinning.
Oh my God.
Dances with... No.
Chasing Amy! Hard 90s! Fucking okay. Kevin Smith.
Kevin Smith, Chasing Amy. We got Joey Lauren Adams.
Joey Lawrence.
Oh my God.
Yeah.
Joey Lawrence. Whoa. But, oh my God, I'm so excited for this one.
Hey, here's my only secret is... Secret time here.
Okay, secret time.
I think this might be the only Kevin Smith movie I've not watched. I don't know I've ever seen this.
Dude, like there's a scene in the bar that like I can relate to so well with this one. I am so excited.
Okay. All right. With that, stay tuned for Chasing Amy.
Next week.
Next episode, I should say.
Yeah. All right. Everybody have a great week. We will see you next week. And we will go over Chasing Amy.
Later. What was that?